that apparently the president has had a quick meet with the prince, Mohammed bin Salman, the Saudi crown prince, who has been fingered in this killing of Jamal Khashoggi, the Washington Post journalist. We also know that he had a moment, that is, the crown prince with Vladimir Putin, sharing a high five there and a fist pump here. But what are the implications of that? These things can happen where you bump into them. This was a meeting, we're told, beyond just the Putin and the Saudi prince exchange, but also the United States president. They had a meeting, or it could have been just a conversation in the hallway. There's no way of knowing, but they did meet. To Solutions Fund Group CIO Larry Chauver on all of this, because Larry, think about it. This comes at a time we're hearing the Saudis and the Russians, not so coincidentally, talk about curtailing production to increase oil prices. So, they're pretty tight. What do you make of this?
Well, at least they weren't riding like shirtless on horseback together, and it was just a fist pump. But that said, I think it goes back to November of 2014. It's like, I can't make heads or tails of what OPEC's doing, what Saudi Arabia is doing, and my suspicion is that the shale industry in the United States has disrupted things so much that both Saudi Arabia and especially Russia, they have to pump when they can and as much as they can. I mean, let's face it, OPEC's taking Saudi Arabia and saying you have to cut production by 500,000 barrels a day. And we find out 2 days ago they're at like an all-time high of 11.1 million barrels a day. So like, it's chaos. And I think that chaos is working in their favor. And, we see that in the market today.
Do you think that the collapse in oil prices has rejiggered everyone's thinking, that there's something bigger going on here apart from machinations of production in Saudi Arabia, Russia, or wherever, and everything to do with just the whole global economy slowing down? We got some weak factory statistics out of China today, similarly weak numbers out of Japan and Europe, a German key production index that's headed south, and London, a shoppers index that's down. You begin to wonder whether there's some fuel to this.
Yeah, I think it's partly true. And adding to that list, you have four countries in Europe with negative GDP for this quarter: Sweden, Switzerland, Italy, Germany. But that said, a little bit. But I think the strength in the dollar has hurt the emerging markets, for the price of oil being well over $100 a barrel in their currency. But I don't think production has, or economic activity has, decreased that much to cause the implosion of the oil price. The fact is, we had a turnaround season that's going to, build inventories, and we had 10 weeks in a row. You have like worst case scenario being built in, factored in over Iran, and eight waivers were given out, and Saudi Arabia was pumping more than anybody knew. So I think this is the new normal, and any big rally in oil needs to be sold. So I don't think economics is number one.
Do you think, by the way, that what's happening with oil is short-lived? A lot of people said it got unnaturally low and it's going to bounce back, and this is all just a fleeting event.
Yeah, I think any kind of rally we have is transitory. But right now, the cure for low prices is low prices. That's one of the oldest adages in the commodities market. The same exact scenario played out April, May, when we were trading in the mid-50s. Everybody was wondering, like, are we going to fall off the map? Is this the end of the world? And guess what? We found buyers. And that's going to happen again. We just had a lot of financial liquidation. People are worried about all these moving pieces and knowns. But I do think we'll see a short-term pop.
All right. We'll watch it closely, Larry. Thank you very much. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
All right.